Reverend Ryk Brown, and welcome to St. James United Church in Waterdown, Ontario, Canada. Or at least, welcome to my living room, because we're still in lockdown and we're not supposed to leave the house. The vaccine is starting to roll out slowly. I bet you can't wait to get back to normal. You know, I hope that never happens. I hope we never get back to normal. What do I mean by that? Well, stick around, and that's what we're going to be talking about today. In the meantime, let's have some singing. Today's scripture reading comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 29 to 31, and it's one of the writings of St. Paul. Let's listen for the Word of God. I mean, brothers and sisters, the appointed time has grown short from now on. Let even those who have wives be as though they had none, and those who mourn as though they were not mourning, and those who rejoice as though they were not rejoicing, and those who buy as though they had no possessions, and those who deal with the world as though they had no dealings with it. For the present form of the world is passing away. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So I was talking earlier about hoping that we don't get back to normal, and said stick around and we'll talk about that. Well, I'm going to talk about Paul's writing first, and then we'll get into what normal is. So today's passage comes from a book written by Paul, 1 Corinthians, and Paul was writing at a time of major social crisis. What was that crisis? Well, historians are a little divided about what the crisis was because he's not specific. Some saw it as the coming end of the world or the fall of Jerusalem, the impending fall of Jerusalem, or the corruption of the new emperor Nero, who tapped into the social anxiety of his day and blamed all of their society's social problems on a minority group. In this case, it was the Christians. And he sent them to the lions to be killed for entertainment. Now, Paul may have been predicting the collapse of Roman society due to what he saw as the moral bankruptcy of its emperor. We can't relate to that at all today, can we? Corrupt governing leadership, public crises, people anxious about the future. Paul wanted to encourage his people to believe that there's more to life than just what we see with our own eyes. And Paul tells his people that the form of this world that they see before them is going to pass away, and it's going to be replaced by a new form. The last phrase, I want to zero in on the very last phrase from today's scripture passage that Paul wrote, where he says, "For the present form of this world is passing away." You know, as the vaccine is starting to roll out, I know many people are eagerly looking forward to getting back to life the way it used to be. But like I said, I hope that doesn't happen. I hope life never goes back to the way it used to be. There were a lot of things wrong with the way life used to be before the pandemic. And being forced to stay at home for the last 10 months has also forced us to see the world in a whole new way. The present form of this world is passing away, as Paul said. The pandemic has forced us to change the way we see the world, to change our priorities, to learn some valuable lessons from the last 10 months about how to live differently. If we just go back to the way things were before the pandemic, then we will have wasted the gift of a new life that God is trying to offer us in the midst of this extended crisis. What do we need to learn? What do we need to learn from the past 10 months? What do we need to change so that we create a new form of this earth, a better form, a better way of living? What do we need to learn as the present form of this world is passing away? Well, I think one of the first things we need to learn is that we're not separate from the environment. We cannot ignore God's creation and continue to abuse it like we have, or it'll fight back. The whole point of the first two chapters of the Bible, the first two chapters of the book of Genesis, is to teach us that we were put on this earth to look after the place on behalf of God. It's our job to nourish this earth, not consume it. We have to realize that as we interact with this world, science and faith should never be at odds with each other. If God is real in this world, then science is also real. Science merely explains God. There is nothing in science that is at odds with our faith. If we think there is, then we're in the wrong, because the virus doesn't care about our beliefs, and no beliefs will save us from its scientific reality. God gave us minds, and God gave us the field of science to learn how to better care for this earth science and faith are one. The second thing that I think we can learn from the last 10 months is that Jesus told us we are all one body together. And it's starting to feel like he meant that a little bit more literally than we've taken it. There's been a whole lot of talk over the last several months about personal freedoms, people exercising their personal freedoms. But personal freedoms are not more important than our social connection. We need to work together more than ever. We need each other. We need each other at all levels of society. No one is an island. One person's actions today can have an impact, positive or negative, on lots of other people. And we've seen that now with the connectivity of the virus as it moves from person to person. You know, there's been a huge divide over the last little while between conservatives and liberals, both here in Canada and the States and all over the world. And I think there's wisdom in both. The conservatives are right about something. We need to be able to look after ourselves in order to get through this crisis. But the liberals are also right that we need to learn to look after each other. Those two don't have to be at odds with each other. We can learn to look after ourselves better and learn to look after each other better. The third thing that I think we need to pay attention to from the last several months is Jesus' call to love your neighbor as yourself. It is more profoundly and more literally true than ever before. If the last year has not taught us to be more compassionate, then we have wasted the time we've been given. We've been forced to learn how to love ourselves because we've been forced to live with ourselves without being able to distract ourselves with all the busyness that we had in our lives before the pandemic. We've been forced to just sit with ourselves and get to know ourselves and discover whether we like ourselves or we don't like ourselves. And those who don't, we've had a chance to change. So we've all been able to learn to love ourselves a little bit more over the last 10 months. And we've also realized in loving each other, because that's what Jesus called us to do, we've realized that inequality in this world harms us and puts us at greater risk. We have to listen to those we're called to love. We have to listen to those who are on the outside edges of society. We have to listen to the poor, the marginalized, the minorities in our midst, now more than ever. Those of us who are privileged need to learn to take a knee as we learn to love our neighbors as ourselves. Not so biblical lesson, but fun lesson that we've got to learn over the last 10 months is that creativity, art, music, poetry, creativity in any form also seems to matter more now than before. It's become like free therapy for us. How many of your friends have taken up new hobbies? How many new hobbies have you taken up? How many new creative outlets have you experienced or seen others experiencing as we're sitting home alone trying to figure out what to do with our time? Well, let's get creative. Lots of people are taking up creative hobbies. That creativity, art, the music, poetry, all of it, it's become free therapy for us. It's more than merely enjoying, it's healing. And the fifth thing I think we need to pay attention to is that personal, physical, mental, and spiritual health matters. A lot of us took it for granted before the pandemic, but we've been forced to pay attention to our bodies over the last 10 months. And you have to take the initiative to look after yourself. It won't happen by itself. Getting outside matters more than it used to. We took it for granted before. connecting with the divine source of all life and love matters. Taking care of your mental health, it matters now more than it did before. And the last lesson I think we need to pay attention to, for those of us in the church, or those of you out there who are thinking about being a part of the church isn't dead. A lot of people have been trying to write off the church. One of the things we've realized over the last 10 months is the old way of being church is absolutely dying. It's been dying for at least a half a century, if not longer. But it sure has accelerated over the last 10 months, really rapidly. The old way of how we used to be church is dying right in front of us, all around us, but also all around us. A new way of being church is being born in our midst. That's the Christmas message. That's the heart of the Christian message. We experience death and we experience resurrection. When one dies, something new is born. As the old church is dying, a new church is being reborn in its midst, in our midst. And we have the honor and the privilege and the excitement to be a part of that. We've learned over the last 10 months that we can still be the church, even without a building. All the things we thought we needed to do our job, we don't need them. What do we need? We need each other. All those things that we used to depend on, the building and everything else, we now know those are optional. And I'm going to have a whole lot more to say about that in an upcoming video that I'm going to be creating for you as we prepare for our annual meeting in a few weeks. Paul said, "The present form of this world is passing away. Something new and exciting and full of hope and compassion and kindness is taking its place. Are you eager to get back to the way life was before? Or are you eager to be part of building a new and better life on earth as it is in heaven?" Because that's what Jesus taught us to pray for. The present form of this world is passing away. So let's build a new one.
The fountain of life flows, and without price goes to all people who abide in the land. There on the banks of a river bright and free, yielding her fruit, firm in her root, the tree of life will be. I see a new I see a new earth as the old one will pass away, where the fountain of life flows and without price goes to all people who abide in the land. There where death dies and our lives are born again, body and soul struggling but whole. Fountain of life flows, and without price goes to all people who abide in the land. There where the darkness brings visions from above, there where the night, bearing new light, reveals the promise of love. where the fountain of life flows, and without price goes to all people who abide in the land. There where we work with the love of healing hands, labor we must, true to our trust, to build a promised new land. I see a new heaven, I see a new earth, as the old one will pass away. Where the fountain of life flows, and without price goes, to all people who abide in the land.
Let's pray. Thank you, God, for the gift of renewal, even in the face of fear, anxiety, and even death. We grieve for those who have lost loved ones during the past 10 months due to the pandemic or any other reasons. We lift up those who have loved ones in hospital now that are wrestling with COVID or having to deal with the reality of COVID while they're trying to get treatment for something else. We lift up all those who are living in fear and anxiety of any kind. And we pray your comforting strength upon them. We acknowledge, God, that something huge has happened in this world over the past 10 months. And it's not just the bad news of the pandemic. The present form of this world is passing away right before our eyes. Help us to resist the temptation to go back to the way things were before, to fall back into old ways, to just go back to living a life that neglects the environment and doesn't do enough as a society to love those who are left out. Help us to learn the hard lessons we need to learn from the isolation we've been forced to experience. Make us more loving, more compassionate. Make us more open to those who are different than we are. Make us more willing to listen and less willing to condemn. Make us kinder towards each other. And make us more mindful of caring for the world that you have given us. We have neglected this planet, and the planet reacted back to us for the last 10 months. Help us to pay attention to the harm we're causing to this planet and to be done with that. Help us to find healthier ways to live and to care for each other and that this planet, to care for this planet that you put us on. We lift these prayers in the name of Jesus, and all God's people say together, Amen. Let's pray to God that life never gets back to normal, at least not the old normal. Let's build a new and better normal together, a more caring normal. Remember that this week. And remember last week? At the end of the service, I encouraged you to go outside and go for a walk after the service was over. I'm going to encourage you to do the exact same thing again this week. Get outside. As soon as this is done, grab your coat, go outside, go for a walk. Do something healthy outdoors that will make you feel better. And when you get back, pick up the phone and call somebody that you haven't talked to in at least a month. Tell them how much you miss them. God bless, and we'll see you next week.